Hey, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Blabbercast. I'm your host, Cameron, and with me, as always, is my co-host and author of The Nicest Parts of Hell, Billy. What's up, Billy?
What's going on, Cameron?
Not much, sir. Not much, sir. Just plowing through Terminator 2 Judgment Day. That's the one we're going to be watching, going over today. Our retrospective this week is the anti-sophomore slump sequel to the 1984 hit Terminator. And holy shit, was this a great movie.
Yeah, right.
It isn't. My God. Kicks off really fast-paced with war scene from the future between the robots, the robits, and the humans. Pretty badass. I actually remember where I first saw this movie, and this was nice. On VHS. Yes, I am that old. It was on VHS in my living room as a kid, and I was just dumbfounded at how awesome this was. This is a great fucking film. You remember the first time you saw it?
I think I saw it in theaters, but it's a little bit blurry.
Really?
So we'll just go with that, Beth. I'm pretty sure, man.
One of the most
numerous times after.
Yeah. One of the most memorable times I watched this flick was with this, it was on a date in high school with this chick. Her name was Amy. I really want to say her last name, but I'm not going to. Her name was Amy, and went to her house. Met her parents and everything, and they were really cool. Her dad was really cool too. He had just got this, like, I forget exactly, but it was like a surround sound system, full Dolby and everything. And he had Laserdisc, and he put this on, and that the beginning scene with the war in the future, when that T-800 foot comes down on that skull, and then just all hell breaks loose. Loud as fuck. And it was like all around. This was the first time I'd ever experienced that in a house. And it just seemed better than a theater.
I don't know why. Surround sound.
So it was just amazing. And of course I was, with this incredibly hot chick as well. Very cool chick too. She was great.
Well, that makes it better.
She got so pissed at her dad. She's like, "Dad, stop it. Stop showing off." Meanwhile, I'm laughing because, like, there's guns and bombs going off and humans getting whacked and robots getting shut down early. And it was just really fucking cool. Great, great show. So let's get into it, brother. July 1991 is released. July 1991.
July 19, yep.
This had a very, very big budget, between $94 and $102 million, largest budget at the time, and most of it went to the special effects and the stunts, too.
That's right, and box office cleared $520 million, obviously more than that over time, but I don't know exactly when the date is. Yeah, I'd like to get more research and see when did they call that $520 million? Is that within the time frame, or... re-releases, it'd be interesting to see. And then how do you not know your exact budget? They're like, I don't know, it's somewhere in there.
I think
y'all keep good books.
I think it was, I'm guessing, and I know that this is going to be a recurring theme, but I'm guessing the real budget was $94 million, and the 102, that extra $8 million, was just all, oh, that's good shit, oh my god.
That's right. The allergies.
Yeah. So. But, and this had a lot of advertising for this film before the film's release. And in fact, that actually caused a problem, too. We'll get into that a little later. But they marketed it a great bit with lots of action figures as. Where you could put the skin on the endoskeletons. I remember those specifically. That was pretty damn cool. little bit old.
C-1000 though did look a bit odd to have that spliced in. It looked like, kind of like a heavy set, dude. I don't know what they were doing with that.
I know. It's like, wow, T-1000 needs to eat a salad. Yeah. Do some crunches.
Yeah, it's fine. It'd be fine. They're just like, yeah, probably child labor making it, but to be honest. But anyway.
Who cares?
Interesting enough, too, though, the T-1000 is a point of issue for the special effects, because obviously they want, Cameron liked to have done that in 94, but they just wasn't ready at the time. But the movie The Abyss,
great movie.
I think Cameron did. He felt that at that point, okay, we can push forward. We can, now I can do my vision of this T-1000, which obviously becomes a hell of a vision. So that was pretty interesting. Then there was a dispute over ownership of the rights, though, between, let's see, Hemdale Corp and Carolco. How do you say that? So,
Carolco.
Hemdale had financial issues, and Arnie urged Carolco to buy the rights to the film. So they settled for $5 million for the franchise in 1990.
Which is an interesting point, because that created a very, very tight shooting schedule for James Cameron. Yeah. And in fact, they released a trailer for the film. I think it was done by Stan Winston, because it was supposed to be like an assembly line of the T-800s being put together and stuff. And James Cameron didn't know that it had been released, or had been green lighted. So he called his co-writer and he's like, I got good news, I got bad news. Good news is we're doing the film. Bad news is we got less than a year to write, shoot, direct, and edit the film. So,
like, fuck.
And like, talk about like getting diamonds under pressure. I mean, less than a year to write this. Wow. I mean, how many years did Ridley Scott have to do Covenant and Prometheus? Jeez. I know. I'll talk to my therapist about my obsession with Ridley Scott. But
I know it's getting bad.
Son of a bitch, dude. It's just so glaring. I mean, for God's sakes.
Well, this was interesting. Greek mythology. But that's the only thing I think missing to make this the perfect film, but that's okay. Let's continue.
Yes. A falafel. Okay. The Abyss, done by Cameron's, used CGI to simulate 3D water. The film flopped, but it did well on home video and had an extended cut, which was better. Not really sure why the studio got, you know, clingy about saving 17 minutes. A Laserdisc version of The Abyss was considered superior.
Yeah, I've always found that weird, too. It's just like, oh, you know, okay, I got to save that time. Then you look at modern shows, and it's, yeah, okay, this person's been literally just staring off into space for about 3 minutes now.
I know,
right? And this is 16 episode season. That's like the Gotham show. I did want to watch it. I saw it's 24 episodes. I'm like, no, thank you. So too much.
So many filler episodes.
Yeah, there has to be. There's just no way. Well, everyone's told me that. This is good. There's a lot of filler. T2 has extended scenes as well. Speaking of extended scenes. Kyle visits Sarah in the hospital in a dream sequence, but poor Michael Biehn cannot be in sequels, so they said nope.
I know, right?
No. He's like such a likable fellow. Sarah and John removing the chip from the Terminator so it can reboot. That was removed. T-1000 footage. That was pretty cool. Kind of brain surgery. Kind of cringy. Like, ugh. T-1000 footage cover. The T-1000 is glitchy after being frozen and reforming. CPU gets more, you do see it glitch a little bit towards the end, but it's very glitchy. It's sticking to things. It's having trouble lifting his feet here and there. He's having to refresh his image more often. His form shifts a bit more when he steps on the metal floor, and his leg becomes metal briefly, then switches back really quick.
Yeah.
It looks really cool looking effect, but they cut it. I'm not sure why, but again,
I think that was
never
just
asked in interviews.
I think that was just a time thing. The problem with the T2 deleted scenes is that they're all good. Like that. Mm. A lot of times when you watch deleted scenes on DVDs and whatnot, you can tell. Like, oh, okay, that was just pointless. It's a good thing they cut that shit out. But a lot of these were really cool. Like the
amazing,
you know, Michael Biehn cameo. The scene where Sarah is removing the old AMD processor and putting a new one with better benchmarks into the TA-100.
Dora, there's an hour-long video with about 20,000 goddamn... I'm sorry, it's fine.
We're going to be doing some new processors, one a week for each one that comes out. That scene was really cool because that actually involved Linda Hamilton's twin sister. And they did like a... Because if you watch that scene, you see her in front of a mirror trying to do the... you know, AMD processor surgery. And that's actually Linda Hamilton in front of the camera. And then it's Linda Hamilton and her twin sister mimicking each other's movements to make it look like it's a reflection in a mirror. So it's pretty badass.
That's cool.
And there's some pretty good dialogue in there too. So yeah, it's too bad all that stuff got cut out. Best version of the film, Laserdisc again. Laserdisc for the win. So technology shouldn't have gone away, but oh well.
And of course, time.
I'm kind of glad that it did because I've got a lot of DVDs.
It's too big. Yeah, it's too big of a disc in general. So it didn't make sense to go to DVD. I mean, it's kind of the same thing in some ways. Well, actually, that's probably blasphemous to say. Somebody's going to kill me.
So. Yeah. So, but apparently, I didn't. There were so many releases of this movie, VHS, Laserdisc, and DVD. I mean, there's probably like 56 different releases of this movie. The Laserdisc had an epic box set, which had tons of extra content and commentaries. All this is ported into the DVD Ultimate Release, which was missing the Guns N' Roses music video. One of my favorite songs from Guns N' Roses, You Could Be Mine. Did feature more scenes, which could be unlocked to gain the alternate ending, which has an older Sarah sitting on a bench watching kids play and seemed a bit cheesy. That was actually when they showed that to test audiences. They thought it was too positive compared to the rest of the film. So that's why they changed that. But that's an interesting, I never saw that. For the longest either. Time. So pretty cool.
Absolutely. There's many Blu-ray releases as well. Getting rid of goddamn ridiculous cash in there. Cash that cow, man. Now it's streaming services instead. There's another one, is there? But yeah, back in that time, there's the ultimate edition. I didn't know that. But we got to go get it.
Super serial edition.
Oh my god, this has an extra commentary track, motherfucker! I have to have this. Not much was even added to it, but James Cameron. I'm going to confuse you. James Cameron did do another commentary, which is apparently worth a listen. Picture quality wasn't really all that improved for the Blu-ray. Oddly enough, the film was shot on Super 35mm. Which is weird to me. I think it's, I don't know the resolution. I don't know if there is a resolution. I guess there's some kind of resolution for 35mm. It seems like they could have squeezed more, but again, I'm not sure of the technical aspect of the Blu-ray. So I did see some DVDs and you'd see people, you know, say, oh, no, the Blu-ray's night and day difference. I'm like, dude, I really can't fucking tell. You're fucking blind. They'd argue. I'm like, never mind. Fuck it. So,
there comes a point when you're doing a movie on Blu-ray or 4K where it's just not going to transition any better because it was shot on, you know, inferior equipment. I mean, so you just got to kind of live with it. So
yeah, exactly. Well, there's some tech stuff that I do have. I'm not sure exactly how this works, but Terminator 2 masks the image to a 2.35.1. basically that crop zooms in and which causes some grain. Laserdisc version is still considered the great quality even for even being non-HD. So basically just as aspect ratios, just think there's more to the picture, but it's just obviously letterbox cropped formatted.
Right.
Best tech explanation I can give you. There's probably somebody else to do a lot better. Well, is somebody to do a lot better job than me at explaining that.
Right. So, I think we had gone mentioned this in Aliens, our Aliens retrospective. Be sure to check that out in our library. James Cameron had the reputation of being a real taskmaster, which I think is like Hollywood code for prick, on the set of his movies. So much so that he earned the nickname Iron Jim. While this was due to an insanely tight filming schedule, only getting, like we said, 1 year to direct and edit the film, Cameron annoyed his crew so much that they reportedly made shirts that said Terminator 3, not with me. Kind of fucked up. but, I mean, you piss off the people you're working with. I mean, you got to kind of take the consequences. Interesting thing to note that the casting for John Connor took a while before Edward Furlong was found. The kid from What About Bob was going to play the part, but ran into scheduling conflicts because he was doing the movie What About Bob. Casting director Molly Finn was told that John needed to be kind of a streetwise kid with attitude, so he went to a boys' club in Pasadena and found Edward Furlong. Ed Furlong was kind of estranged from his mom, grew up without his dad, very much like John Connor, and he was brought before James Cameron and Arnold, and they both agreed that he was right for the job.
He'll do pretty fine. Cool. All right, I can't do it. But anyway, yeah. It's been a long time.
I want the kid.
Oh, my gosh. All right. So Arnold took Furlong under his wing. Furlong grew up, as you said, without a father. So he looked up to Arnold, which figures he's a big dude. Linda Hamilton would hear Schwartzy giving Furlong advice about women. She was saying, "Man, damn. So when you make love to her in the future, you should explode in the pussies, be very vet."
Yeah, so, yeah, you okay. Just got to do a bunch of half hole.
Hamilton said she thinks Arnold and Edward got along so well because they were emotionally the same age. So like kids, you know, in general.
That's awesome.
Linda Hamilton went permanently deaf in one ear during the elevator scene in the mental hospital. She took out her earplugs and the sound of the gunshots made her go deaf in one ear.
That was crazy. As you
rewatched the film, it must have been really fucking loud. So
yeah,
and the echoes are just
right even back with ear protection. That must have been deafening.
That happened. So. Yeah, it's like fuck that. Denzel Washington turned down the role of Miles Dyson, saying all he does is look scared and sweat. No thanks. So Jesus.
Kind of true.
But he did a little bit more.
He did do more, but. Yeah,
not much more. Okay.
Yeah.
Good job by that guy. Though. So there was an alternate ending originally, which we talked about, older Sarah at the park, and son John was the, so he was a senator at that point. And we said Tessa and said it was too positive. So there we go.
Pretty
and
interesting.
That's something we will cut in about here. We mentioned it twice, but that's okay. Joe Morton played Miles Dyson, so he did a very good job.
Yes. Joe Moore. I've seen him in a whole bunch of stuff, like in SWAT. Well, he was really good, and he's done a lot of stuff. And Earl Bowen coming back as Dr. Silberman from the first one. He's got a more extended role in this one, so really got to see the played that Weasley kind of prickish psychiatrist. He did a really good job with that.
He's fantastic. Shitting himself in that hallway.
Yeah, it's so a man walks into a bar. Yeah, it was pretty cool. Cool opening scenes. Cool opening, I should say, and the more enhanced future war was shot. Those scenes really like sparked my interest and curiosity about like the lore and has stuff that hasn't happened yet, but it was really cool. I've always kind of had a thing for dystopian stuff, so that was probably one of all the stuff about the future really just piqued my interest, even in the first Terminator when they had flashbacks or dream sequences. That stuff really got me going. We're
getting close to that. Klaus Schwab's like, oh, yeah, yeah. But, oh, I used to be a Nazi. Oh, oh. Like, if you can make it, old man, we'll see. TikTok, motherfucker.
So. Unfortunately, we're just going to be fighting just really feisty Roombas. I don't think we have the technology yet for this.
Yeah, I don't think so. I think we'll be okay. No.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome. So, opening scene. You got two Terminators again sent back through time. Well, the first time was not a Terminator, obviously, but you get the two. We're not sure which one's which, like the first. Just goes right into it. Arnold gets the clothes and the boots and bike. Oh, yeah.
Interesting to note that whole bar scene was almost omitted. They almost cut that out. Yeah. Yeah. They, surprise. Arnold argued and fought for that to be in.
He said, I like that thing.
I think what they quoted him saying was, it's corporate types like you that would cut something like that out. Something to that effect. So
nice.
And then he made like a sniffing gesture in a straight line.
Allergies. Yeah, allergies. We haven't done one yet, so don't worry. Here we go. We're about to
attack the pollen.
Yeah, it's like you two met repetitive. cocaine. There. So anyway, that's a comment from last week. So anyway, Jesus. So there's one point though where they play. You know, he gets the glasses and the badge of the bone starts to play.
Yeah,
it's a bit of a giveaway that's a good one at that point, but it's still good. That scene needs to stay in.
Yep.
And then we got next. What is going on? I can't
remember. T-1000, played by Robert Patrick, does an amazing job. This guy was fucking creepy.
Incredible.
He jacks a cop. He hijinks him. And then they show how they had Sarah trying to stop Cyberdyne and is locked up in a mental institution. It's pretty believable. Like, this, you don't really... The first time you meet Sarah, she's in locked up in the mental institution. She's doing pull-ups and she's all sweating. She's got the scowl. She does not look like the woman you met back in 1984. So it's been, what, 6, 7, 8 years? And she's...
It's been a while.
She's pretty jacked. And
yeah, she got in shape.
She's fucking feisty, too. And it's a believable pathway from point A in Terminator, point B in T2. So that's pretty good, believable pathway. She has to sound crazy. So somewhere between the first and the second, she went a wee bit batshit, but it's understandable.
Hey, she had a kid that would drive anybody crazy.
One thing I'd like to point out is that the friend of John Connor, his name's Tom Cooksey. I think he was the lead singer or lead guitar player in a band called Bad for Good. And it was really cool because they were a band full of teenagers and they were playing hard rock, heavy metal. And that was the first time I saw something like that. I was like, son of a bitch, you could do that. So
likable awesome. Kid too. Grabs the picture and looks at it. I don't know. Made it believable. It's not bad. That mullet's a plus one.
There's that meme has a picture of him and Robert Patrick in the arcade. It says saves humanity by instinctually lying to a cop.
There you go. Pretty funny. Something to know. They get the awesome arcade scene, which is going to lead into the corridor fight.
Yep.
If I saw this in person, which I'll get into in a second, I would have trouble walking away from it. I'd be like, I should probably run away, but this is interesting. So I'd just be frozen. People would have their phones out and it'd be called a deep fake, I guess, or something like that now. So see, now that's all the deep fake. So it's all making sense. So I see your game. I see your game now, Klaus Schwab, son of a bitch. He's going to hear this. It's like, you're 196, bro. TikTok. All right. He might be a nice guy. I don't know.
Yeah. That poor random guy in the hallway.
Yeah. That part was kind of funny, though, because he's just standing there, right? And he's just standing there. John gets down. Guy's still standing there. When the T-1000 shoots, he just jumps right in front of the bullet. It's like, laughing. Like, that part was fucking hilarious. Like, just standing there.
There was a moment when I watched that and I was like, wait a second. Is he having a sweet rave party? oh no, he's getting shot.
It's like, well, don't stand in front of the bullets, bro. Get down to maybe he just stands there. It's very weird.
Well, I mean, I think it would be plausible to think that the fucking guy would be like, oh, okay, the cop's not going to shoot me. And then he gets shot by the cop. But could be wrong.
True.
He's could be too that, busy yeah. drinking his product placement Pepsi. So
there you go. Yeah. Placed very nicely.
Yeah, the chase scene through the canal is awesome all the way through. This movie is moving along very fast. Interesting part when I don't know. We were talking about this earlier. We don't know what that canal is. I think that's got something to do with the Los Angeles River. Not really sure, but whatever yeah, that canal knows, is.
Answer that, please. Comment, answer that.
Someone yeah, knows. Please let us know. If you're a LA native, correct us. Or
I know at least 500 people watch this shit, so I want to be all my motherfuckers.
At least. No more.
I'm much more than that these days. So.
Yeah.
But that was a reaction video. All right, go ahead, sir.
So that semi that Robert Patrick gets in to chase them, they realize that that was too big to fit underneath some of those canal bridges. Mm-hmm. And James Cameron's, you know, that was kind of got frustrated. He's like, well, I guess the fucking roof's going to have to come off. And that's why when the semi goes underneath that first kind of canal bridge or underpass or whatever, the top mm-hmm. of it gets ripped off. That was just purely Cameron saying, well, this is happening. Make it happen. So
I bet it was angry too. Well, then the top's coming off. It's going to happen. All right, fuck it. And it worked out. So there you go. So you get angry and it makes things work.
Now, I don't know if anybody out there is a motorcycle enthusiast, but I've grown up around motorcycles and ridden motorcycles all my life. And one thing that always bothered me was in movies, you always notice that the motorcycles don't sound like what they really are. The chase sequence from the mall into that canal thing, John Connor gets on a Honda XR75, I believe, and that's a four-stroke dirt bike. And the four-stroke engines have kind of a thumpity-thump-ish sound, unless it's like an inline four. But you hear a two-stroke engine, which gives more like a ring-ding-ding-ding-ding type sound. Always kind of wondered why this happened. And did some research, and that's because rarely the sounds that you hear in the movie are from the actual filming when they actually record the scene. There are people called Foley artists that add sounds after in like post-production. So they see someone walking upstairs and they got to make the sound of footsteps right. going upstairs and stuff like
that. The boom is not going to be near the motorcycle. You might be able exactly. to put a microphone on it. So the boom's far away, so it's going to sound too far away. So yeah, that makes sense why they have to do it after.
They still could like take the fucking time and like get an accurate sound. But depending on the production budget, you know, they may not have that stock footage or stock audio footage of the correct sounding motorcycle. So kind of makes sense, but still kind of pisses me off as a motorcycle enthusiast. You know, you see a Ducati and then you hear a Harley, you're just like, god damn, these sons of bitches. Fuck you. All right, moving on.
A lot of nice tidbits here. You get the foster mom impersonation, which I thought was clever. That's it's different too. And then Arnold talking to the other one, what's the dog's name? Yeah, he says it, Wolfie or whatever, says the name, and he figures out, okay, your foster parents are dead. It's kind of funny.
You know, I'm sure the rest of the audience knows this already, but I was very slow, and I never knew why the Terminator did that. And it wasn't up until like doing research for this film, I was like, oh, he called the dog by the wrong name to see if that was actually the T-1000.
When I first saw it a few times, it took me a while to get that. I don't know what that was. I was, maybe they just called it, was a Nick pet name or something.
Exactly. That's what I thought too. And I'm thinking to myself, wow, the Terminator's dumb. But turns out
the Terminator's Smart.
Oh. Oh, that's right. I'm dumb. Okay. That explains a lot. Moving on.
That's cool. You're seeing some different things from the T-1000. You're already seeing so much shit. And obviously, Robert Patrick is killing with that run he's doing.
Yep.
Fucking fast. And that hawk like look. I can't even describe it. He kind of has a mob look, which really works. It's creepy. Well, it's scary.
It or
country,
is.
Which you're going to do the country thing. Is that John Connor? What if he was like,
are you John Connor, boy? Oh, shit. I got you. Come here, you little sumbitch. I'm going to kill you. Yeah.
Maybe it went down a few pegs if they did that.
Yeah. Might have lost a little credibility if the T-1000 sounded like a hermit from West Virginia.
Son. What in tarnation?
What in tarnation? Who's that? That ain't Uncle Bob, you sumbitch. Yeah, T-1000 sounded like that wouldn't work. Interesting to note, though, I didn't know this, but Robert Patrick, he went all like super method acting on his role to play, you know, a liquid robot. He studied how bald eagles looked and searched for prey, and he studied the movements of great white sharks, or just sharks in general, how they went after their prey. And he did a lot of breathing techniques so that he would only breathe through his nose to simulate what like an actual machine would do, because a machine wouldn't open its mouth to breathe when under duress, like running and stuff. So fucking yeah. Robert Patrick's a badass, dude.
He's a badass, man. He's a lot of shit's coming together in this film. It's just constant. This, you're getting bombarded, just like fucking milk to the face.
Straight up whole milk.
Whole milk, fair life, even better. Fucking pasteurized. God,
delicious.
That's good for 2 weeks, I 2 months.
Okay, we got to move on. It's going to take 2 hours. Let's move on.
Yeah, no, it's like an hour. God damn it. Y'all shut up. Stop this beer. Stop talking.
You motherfuckers.
That'd be funny. The Terminator's an Indian call center scammer. Like, you get back here, you motherfucker.
The Bollywood Judgment Day.
Oh, if they make it, I'm watching that shit anytime. All right.
I'm buying the laser disc of that. Anyways.
I am too. As you get the, I swear I won't kill anyone, which is clever because then he kind of handicaps the T-800s. He's like, he can't kill anyone at that point.
Yeah.
So he just handicapped him. But in a good way, that scene too, when he calls the guys over, it takes them so long to walk over. So they got to get there. They're not that far away. And then they have to have a bit more dialogue.
Yeah, yeah.
It's minor, but it's like, I don't know, they're taking their sweet ass time. They're not fighting now. Should we go over there? They could argue. And that's nothing you take a point on for by any means. But yeah, I like that scene. He's just going to shoot the one dude. And he's like, oh, what are you doing? Just going to shoot him. I'm like, I'm a Terminator, of course, whatever.
Yep.
That's awesome. Whole scene, and they get to the because he orders him. So, well, fuck, you have to listen to me. So they go to the hospital because T-800 says it's going to go after your mom. She's already going to be dead, blah, 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 blah. Kid knows, hey, you have to listen to me. So that whole hospital scene is, we're going to talk about that for a bit, was absolutely awesome. Epic. And every bit of it makes sense. Right, Ridley?
You hear that, Mr. Scott? I ain't talking to Michael, you son of a bitch.
The orderly, David fixed it. It was fine. The orderly, when the orderly licks her, which is weird, and he does this, I'm like, what the fuck was that?
Yeah. Pretty official. That was creepy. It's, I've heard horror stories of, you know, people in.
Oh, there's some fucked up shit now.
There's some fucked up shit. So one of the epic scenes that conveyed the whole like CGI awards that they got was the floor scene where the T-1000 shows its abilities, where, you know, it masks itself as the floor. The guard walks over it. And you see it coming, forming back into a human shape is pretty cool. It opening the elevator doors and then getting the headshot and it just kind of reforms always made me wonder, how the fuck would you kill this thing?
That's what I was thinking when I remember seeing it. I'm like, wow, he's overpowered, but it's like, fine, it doesn't, it's not too much. So there's got to be a way to hurt it. It's more of a curiosity. There's got to be a way to hurt it, but it just, you can't do much to it. Just probably, it's got to be one of the best villains of all time. I mean, it's easily top five.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's up there with Joker and all that kind of stuff.
Oh, yeah. Got it. It's my favorite. Yeah. And then obviously they get away after a dicey chase scene. And you have a very kind of long info dump area that they go to the abandoned garage, and then they go to Mexico. And then Sarah's like, nope, I got to go back, kill Miles Dyson, you son of a bitch. And then they decide, you know, they info dump to Miles Dyson what he inadvertently does to humanity. He wants to stop it. They go to Cyberdyne, try and blow the whole place up. They fight some more. Miles dies in the ensuing battle. Building blows up. And then there's like another chasing, basically, to that smelting foundry or whatever the fuck that place is, the big industrial complex that they go to. And this ushers in the new film tech for CGI for sure. The T-1000's frozen by the cryogenic nitro, not glycerin, but I forget what it was that semi. And I thought the movie was over at that point. It's like, oh, okay, they found a way to stop him. And then you see all the heat starting to melt, and I'm like, holy shit, there.
I know, like, still, like, good grief. Like, what the fuck do you have to do?
Like, at that point, I was absolutely exhausted. Like, I was at that just point, like,
well, I'm like, fuck it, just kill me, bro.
Exactly. I would have been like, well, I guess I'm Newt and I'm gone. So,
yep. Fuck them kids.
Yeah, fuck them kids.
No, that was good. They have that whole, and that's a long, as fuck, it's like 25, 30 minutes in that facility. Like that. Good. Yeah. Why, then he impersonates John Connor's mom at one point.
Yep.
That's a cool scene. Ends up, looks like he kills the T-800 at one point. Which is sad. Then you're going to get more sads at the end of this, but he finds alternate power, pulls the thing back out. Then they finally figure out a way, I guess, just they throw him into the, was that smelting shit? What do you call that?
Yeah, it's smelting pot.
Orange goo.
Orange goo, which is much more believable than black goose.
There we go.
Which you son of a bitch.
There's a lot. There's so much of that end scene. Obviously, you can go over for a while, but just everything with that. And then he's like, when he's dying, he's the shapes of all the people he had taken. That's pretty cool.
That was pretty cool. Yeah. Yeah.
And that just CGI is like, it still looks really good. I mean, it doesn't, it's aged fine. It doesn't look bad. I don't know what they were fucking using, but they did a really good job with the CGI the entire time. They made it good, and that was, they finally killed that motherfucking thing, and then you get the sad scene where, Arnie's got to go. I now know why you could die, something I cannot do. Yeah. Himself. It's tough because you have that father-son relationship, and I'm like, I do get a little bit like, God damn it.
Yeah.
Fuck. So it's like, that's kind of tough.
It just hits you right in the AMD feels.
Right. I know. That's one thing I thought. Where would the T-1000's processor be? It has to have some kind of a processor. Like I said, I don't want that explained, by the way. Don't explain it, but that's interesting. But I think it's better not to know.
Yeah, it has something to do with silver goo. I guess there's one part.
Yeah.
There's one part where the T-800, after they kill the 1000, that he realizes he has to go into the orange goo to make sure that there's no physical evidence of the Cyberdyne microchip in his head or wherever it is,
right? Until then, yes.
And so he's got to go into the goo, and John Connor's like, no, you can't. And there's one line that Arnold says, he's just like, sorry. It just seems so kind of like whatever, shut up kid, I gotta go kill myself. It was just as one part, probably the only part in the entire movie that kind of took me out of it. And it's just like, wow, that was delivered a little bit too funny for my morbid sense of humor to disregard. So
yeah, they did try to give a little bit of more personality to him.
Yeah,
to a degree. I don't think some people think he's not a good actor. I don't really have a problem with Schwarzenegger. I don't think he's bad. I really don't. I don't think everyone's going to pull these roles off. So I don't know. I mean, somebody says words and they say some words, but he did a good job. He did a really great job in this. And if you look at his resume, I mean, shit actors don't usually have that kind of resume.
Yeah.
I think he did a fine job in this film. Very good.
Yeah. I mean, I think at the beginning of his career, yeah, he was like typecasted as the super muscly type figure. He did the Hercules in New York and Conan, right, and then, of course, Terminator stuff, and Predator. But he's done a lot of good stuff. And he did comedy like Twins and,
did his Housekeeper?
That was a comedy too. I like the way you mop. God, he's never gonna like us.
It's funny.
He's very funny. He did Twins and God, what was that? The other Junior. James Cameron one.
Other James Cameron.
The True Lies.
True Lies, yeah. True Lies. I never seen that. I need to watch that. So I've never seen that to this. Everyone says it's awesome. I've never seen
it. It's really good. Great action flick. And it's very funny, too. Sorry. Fucking hilarious. I do like Arnold Schwarzenegger. It kind of reminds me of, like, Tom Cruise. A lot of people have problems with him and shit. I love him. They're both fucking great. So.
Well, yeah, I don't have a problem with Cruise either. That was a good job. And then, Brad Fidel composes again, but he has Moa Money, which really greatly enhances the score. It's like, I can do things. Oh my, look at all these toys. You know, so that's good for him because the first time it wasn't even have as much to work with.
Yeah, I think T-1000, he had a
Casio. Yeah, it was. He didn't have much. You know, now this time he really brought that theme, amped it up. Steroids.
Absolutely. Yeah.
T-1000 theme's creepy. It's kind of like Knives. Like, I can't do it, but it sounds fucking awesome.
Right.
Very good job. He's surprised how much praise he got over the years, but he has inspired many people. And he shouldn't be surprised. Yeah. Did great work. I mean, this is one of those films where it's not just one thing. There's a lot of parts that come together to make
very well put.
And it's arguably one of the greatest films of all time. Action or not, it's way up there.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. It's one of the GOATs for sure.
And that's my final thoughts on it.
Wrap this up. I'll go into my final thoughts. Poor Michael Biehn doesn't get a lot of sequel love. God bless him. Written out of Alien 3 and deleted out of Terminator 2. I love you, bro. Yeah. So sorry. I wish he did one. I don't know the name of this one movie, but he played a villain and it was the scariest thing I've ever seen. Like he was like, it wasn't like a monster. He was like a mob boss or some shit like that. Mm-hmm. And he was like the most scariest antagonist I've ever seen. I got to find that film. I really like Michael Biehn. Of course, is Corporal Hicks and then Kyle Reese, of course. But he's a great
actor. A lot of the guys that come off as very nice, they'll play villains extraordinarily well. It's Jack Gleason did Joffrey Baratheon. Is apparently one of the nicest fucking people ever. It's weird how they can just tap into this evil thing, and they're not an evil at all, not an evil bone in their body. It's very weird.
What a prick. Yeah. But so Terminator 2 is the perfect sequel, which says a lot, like Rogue One, prick. Avoiding the sophomore slump by elaborating on more of the already well-established lore of the previous film, while not going too far with storytelling license and keeping it within the story itself. Setting what should have been a successful template for others to follow, Ridley. And unfortunately, this trend of time travel is not typecasted, but typewritten for all the forthcoming films, Salvation excluded, I think. And I think this is what plagues the whole franchise, the future sequels, into setting them up for failure. While eliciting an Inception-like mind-twisting ruminations, the time travel fad has worn itself off by the end of this film, Terminator 2, and unwittingly set the groundwork for future sequels to prosper on as as of yet, untold stories of the future in a pop, like an apocalyptic story, the collapsed society amidst a nuclear fallout, a Holocaust-like movie with all of humanity being rounded up for extermination. Although that's kind of a la Terminator Salvation. But in addition, there was this trend of keeping an old Terminator like the T-800 and having it square off against an even more advanced Terminator, and with each subsequent film having the antagonistic Terminator being even more and more technologically advanced, I think this makes for a faux pas in the whole franchise. Why not just send the more advanced Terminator the first time around and imagine the line of Terminators that have to be sent back to the future before the humans win the war, shutting off the Skynet mainframe? You know, it's like you got like a line of 11 Terminators trying to go back before the humans turn off the power, basically. I think it doesn't make sense, and therein lies the problem of keeping that trend of time travel. I think they shouldn't have kept doing the time travel thing. I think Skynet technically never sends any Terminators back through time. I think it's all part of future John Connor's plan for if no Terminators get sent back, then nothing ever happens. His mom never gets pregnant. He never gets born. Humans never win the war. It's all the intentions of the future John Connor to ensure humanity's survival. Blow that mind, Mr. Scott. No fucking Greek shit anywhere. T2 is hailed as a success, and it has earned every merit, in my opinion. Even the deleted scenes are worthy of being restored into the film, kind of like how some of those deleted scenes got put into a future release of Aliens. As a slightly older boy watching T2 on VHS, it further expanded my fascination with time travel, the Terminator franchise, and all things dystopian. I thirsted for more of the future war, which the novelization of the book Terminator 2 Judgment Day actually expanded on. So that was really cool. But you can't pick apart this film too much. It's a 10 out of 10. And for me, that says a lot. We're obviously very critical of stuff. And like you said, Billy, this is probably arguably one of the best films ever. So that's my final thoughts on Terminator 2.
And no titties or sex. I still got it.
Yeah, I was going to leave that part up.
I'm adding it back in. I ain't going to let you do that. I feel a little bit dirty. But now it did make me think of a couple other things, though, with that. For me, it really ends here. Anything they do after, outside of Salvation, that's fine. Anything they do, this would end. Oh, fuck it, never mind. So, yeah, the franchise kind of ends here. Anything after is just a fanfic thing to me. I can enjoy it. I'll enjoy I've not seen, we'll do Dark Fate, which I haven't seen yet. I will watch it. I did actually enjoy Genesis because I love Emilia Clarke. I think she is one of the nicest people.
That was really good.
I thought they did a good job with it. It's an alternative story. They're not going to stop. If it's artistic integrity, yeah, she'd stop it too and say, fuck it. We can't top that shit. Just stop. That's not the way it works. There's another 100 million or more to make. They're going to go keep doing it until they no longer can make it. So that's the way it works.
I agree.
I know T3 was T, and we'll get to all of them, but T3, it's interesting, but again, the tits were kind of milked on this, and it just gets overly fucking confusing.
Really like T3.
I do like it. Yeah. I didn't think
now it was basically just another, like, T2 on steroids, really. And it just further expanded.
She was very pretty.
Huh?
The Terminator was very beautiful.
Oh, God. She was great.
I look at that. I'm like, yeah, it was a good film. I'm heterosexual, man. I can do that. I can say she did a great job acting. I say it's a pretty good film. Just, it's like Kate Beckinsale in a movie. I'm like, it wasn't bad.
Yeah.
What was it about? I don't know. But it wasn't bad.
So. I identify as she's hot. So
yeah, me too.
Hashtag T3 was great. It expanded on the lore of John Connor and how the Future War came to be. So I consider that part of the canon.
Right.
That's and then fine. I think what you had was after that was what Salvation, which initially I was so hard up for because I thought it was finally the fucking movie that I wanted, which was a movie completely about the Future War, like you saw in glimpses of T1 and T2. And while it was very, very early in the Future War, like T-800s hadn't even, like, they'd just come out at the end of the movie. You still had like the T-600s, which had rubber skin and were easily identified, but you still got that dystopian humanity on the run, concentration camps killing, you know, loads of humans every day and stuff like that. So, yeah. And John Connor was, you know, played by Christian Bale, who I love. And then you also had Bryce Dallas Howard, playing John's love interest. And the other story that went on, I thought that was a great, I thought that was a good movie and that added to it. Then you had Genesis, which I liked, and then Dark Fate, which just, you know, made me, we'll get into it, but yeah. God, here we go.
Yeah.
Here we go. I wonder if Ridley has a producing credit on that. Anyways, I agree. I think if you had ended the series here at T2, it'd have been the perfect franchise.
Yeah, exactly. That'd be perfect. But again, it's not something they're going to do. For a franchise that's, what, 60? That's pretty good, though. They have a lot of good films out of the six, so it's fine. I don't know if they probably will eventually make another one. You know, but it wouldn't surprise me anyway. Yeah.
Yeah.
And this one, and one other thing between this and T1. T1 is extraordinarily good. I do like that. I think this is a better movie just because it's so much is fucking in it.
Yeah.
And I've never seen anything like a T-1000. Like, even to this day, I'm not sure what they do with the other show. I'm sure they try to make them more overpowered, but this was more natural. And Robert Patrick nails everything. You know, bald eagle, the hawk type look.
Mm-hmm.
He's a menacing villain. I'm like, how do you kill it? Very intimidating. It's creepy. And you have your Terminator that's the good guys, the underdog. And those stories work really well. They, to this day, they've always worked well. They work well in wrestling storylines and this and that. So, yeah, it's just amazing. Something that I haven't actually watched in a long time, but it's one of those things I've watched so many fucking times. I just already know the movie. So it's I've already seen it so many times. I don't need to see it. It's already in my, I can play it in my head almost whenever I want. It's that memorized.
It's like Kevin Smith said, I've watched Star Wars so much, I probably never watch it again in my entire life.
Well, I think Jens Walbach said he couldn't watch anymore.
That's probably, well, yeah. Since I have no Jens Swallowcock, I've literally watched Terminator 2 so much that when I was watching it for research on this show, I barely looked at the screen because I knew the movie by heart. I could hear it and see the images in my head. It was just
that means how good it was. Testament to how good it is.
Exactly.
It means it's perfect pacing and all that. The only thing the Mexico thing, I get, you gotta have a slowdown. I wasn't crazy about the Mexico part. You do get some character building there. Yeah, if I'm really nitpicking, but there's nothing really here that I take. I mean, there's nothing I'd say. There's nothing you can do to make this film any better.
Yeah.
I don't think so.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
There's some more final thoughts as we're getting the milk and the tits out of this one. So.
Yes.
It's milking it like this franchise, man. So.
Dose final thoughts. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, we are done this week. Guys, thank you so much for hanging out with us. All you new subscribers, thank you for hanging out with us and joining the show. Be sure to check out the Wrestler Show. We got about 30, 32 videos now going on. So check out some of the other ones, especially the last five. They need some love too. Check us out on Twitter, at Blabbercast1. leave a comment. Let us know if we missed some stuff, what your favorite part about this is, some fan theories. I've read some really interesting fan theories about this. Check the description below. We got a link to a very cool book that my co-host wrote, The Nicest Parts of Hell. You can get that on a hardback, Kindle and Audible version. Check it out. Really awesome book, quick read. Hit that subscribe button so you can join us for every other video we're going to do. Any suggestions on what we need to do a retrospective on, send us a message on Twitter or leave a comment below, and we'd love to do some more retrospectives on what you guys want to see. So with that, you're going to be out. Billy, you have a good week, sir.
You do the same.
There you go. See you.